Welcome to the first meeting of session six and of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. I am Fiona Hislop, MSP for Linlithgow, and as the oldest member of the committee, I have the pleasure of convening this meeting for the first two items of business. I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome all members, and I look forward to working with you on this committee. So, before we move to the first item on the agenda, I would like to remind everyone present to switch mobile phones to silent. The first item on our agenda is declaration of interests, and this is an opportunity for us to declare any interests we have that are relevant to the work of the committee. There's a background paper provided on declaration of interest. Paper one. First of all, can I declare that I do not have any interest to declare for the purposes of this committee? I'm then going to introduce each of our members to make their declaration. I should add that the members of this committee are Natalie Don, Jackie Dunbar, Liam Kerr, Monica Lennon, Dean Lockhart, and Mark Ruscoe. And what I propose to do is I will ask every member individually in alphabetical order to declare any interest. And if you can wait till I call your name, and that allows broadcast to unmute your mic so we can proceed. So the first member of the committee that I would invite to declare their interest is Natalie Don.
Thanks, convener. I'd just like to declare that I am still a councillor with Renfrewshire Council. So just in case any of the issues that we're discussing cross over with that, I just wanted to make that put that on record. Thanks.
Thank you, Natalie. Any other interests? Natalie,
Oh,
that's your.
sorry. No, that's all my interest. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Natalie. Can I now call on Jackie Dunbar?
Good morning. My interest is nearly the same as Natalie's. I am still a serving councillor for Aberdeen City Council, and I thought I would declare that interest just in case it coincides with anything that we're going to be discussing within this committee. And that's all my interests.
Thank you very much, Jackie. Can I now call on Liam Kerr?
Thank you, convener. I don't believe that I have any particular interest to declare, although going forward, members and viewers may be interested to know that I have a very small shareholding in a community hydroelectric project in Aberdeen.
Thank you very much, Liam. Can we now move on to Monica Lennon?
Good morning. No relevant interest to declare.
Thank you, Monica. Can we now move on to Dean Lockhart?
Thanks, Fiona. Good morning. I have a minority shareholding in a smart meter company based in England. Otherwise, nothing to declare.
Thank you very much, Dean. And finally, can we move to Mark Ruscoe?
Thanks, convener. Nothing to declare.
Thank you very much, Mark. We now move on to agenda item two, which is the task of choosing a convener. The procedures explained in the choice of the convener paper, paper two. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party are eligible for nomination as convener of this committee. And I would like to nominate Dean Lockhart as convener of this committee. Can we ask, has everyone agreed that we choose Dean Lockhart as our convener? As I see nothing in the chat bar to disagree, can I congratulate Dean Lockhart on his appointment? I look forward to working with you and the other members of the committee. And can I now pass over to Dean Lockhart, our convener?
Well, Fiona, thank you very much, and to other members of the committee. It's a great privilege to become convener of this committee. We have tremendously important work ahead of us, and I look forward to working with all the members, the clerks to the committee, Spice, and everyone else who will be engaged with the committee's work going forward. The next agenda item is item number 3, which is the choice of a deputy convener. And the Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are eligible for nomination as deputy convener of this committee. So on that basis, I invite a nomination for the post of deputy convener.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to make a nomination, if I may, I would like to nominate Fiona Hislop, MSP, as for the post of Deputy Convener, please.
Thank you very much, Liam. And is the committee agreed that Fiona Hislop will be the Deputy Convener of the committee? Fantastic. I see no comments, so let me congratulate Fiona. And many congratulations, Fiona, on becoming Deputy Convener of the Committee, and I very much look forward to working with you from today onwards on the work we have ahead in the Committee. Thank you, Fiona. The next item on the Committee agenda is Item 4, Decision on Taking Business in Private. The Committee is now asked to consider taking Item 6, of the agenda, which is the consideration of our approach to developing a work programme, to take that agenda item in private. Are members agreed? That is agreed. The next item on the agenda is agenda item 5, consideration of session 5 legacy reports. The committee is invited to consider a number of legacy reports prepared by relevant committees in the past session of Parliament. They outline the committee's main work and identify potential challenges that we face in this current committee in the next session, or this coming session. Legacy reports have been identified from 3 former committees of Parliament which are relevant to this committee. These are the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee, and the Rural Committee and Connectivity Committee, all of which covered areas which are now relevant to the work of this committee. The clerk's paper for this item draws attention to the most relevant items in those legacy reports. And under this item of business, we are invited simply to formally note these reports and further agree to consider their contents as part of our work programme going forward. I will take this read by members. As part of this agenda item, and as this is our last item of business today before we go into private session, I would like to take this opportunity for all members to have a brief discussion of the key points arising from those legacy reports from the relevant committees, and for members to highlight briefly any particular areas falling within this committee's remit that they consider important that this committee looks at in inquiries or in investigations going forward. So with that in mind, let me start with the Deputy Convener to get the Deputy Convener's views of some of the important priorities and topics that this committee should look at going forward. So let me hand over to Fiona.
Thank you very much, Dean. I look forward to working with everybody in this committee, and I think there's a big challenge ahead of us. Clearly, the import of the subject matters that we are responsible for in the Parliament is huge. I was very impressed with the content of the legacy papers. They are very wide, clearly because of the wider remit of the other committees and the different range. But I think there's some specific steers that are very important, very strong. I'm very keen that the committee hits the ground running. And there's a lot of agenda items that are very immediate, some maybe more longer term, but I'm particularly conscious that with COP26, we really need to move quickly to understand and get an appreciation of the developments there at all levels. And I think particularly in terms of preparation, but also in output and outcome, and the role particularly of Scotland within that. And particularly with young people, and working potentially with Italy in terms of what they're doing with the young people strand in particular. In other areas, particularly looking at implementation, I think the agendas of our previous committees in the last session clearly set out what had to be done, why it had to be done, how it had to be done, and in terms of timetables, etc. There's a great deal of scrutiny has to take place. So I think for me, the main focus needs to be on implementation. I've got a particular interest in different energy uses and implementation and innovation. I think we should be working with our colleagues on the Economy Committee in terms of jobs and the green recovery. I think the work of the Just Transition Commission is really important, and we can move very quickly on that. And also two other areas which others might touch on as well. Infrastructure is going to be very important, particularly housing refit and the net zero agenda, but also communities. How do we make sure that across Scotland our communities are not just in receipt of issues, but are actually leading them? So I think there might be something there. And finally, and I'm probably taking up everybody else's kind of scope, but I thought it might be helpful as deputy just to kind of do the scoping. I'm conscious in terms of membership of the committee that we don't have MD from the Highlands and Islands or the south of Scotland. And I think it might be appropriate to make sure in terms of our engagement, looking at the advice from the legacy committees, that we're particularly cognizant of the communication engagement work, and particularly with those parts of the country. But on that, I'll end, Dean, if that's not too much for you.
Great, Fiona. Thank you very much. No, I think it's very helpful to set the scene as you just did. And I'm sure other members will have additional items to bring in. And we'll continue on alphabetical order to bring members in. So that means we have Natalie Dawn, followed by Jackie Dunbar. So Natalie, over to you.
Hi, welcome convener, thanks for bringing me in. So yeah, absolutely, I think the deputy has it spot on in terms of COP26. We really need to sort of move quickly and know exactly what our aims are. Some of my particular interests tend to be on our green recovery, around our climate change and net zero, and specifically in transport and infrastructure. I think that's going to be really, really key going forward. I think the drive away from sort of cars and just making, improving public transport is going to be a massive remit for us. I also was interested in what the deputy convener was saying about community empowerment. So that's something, as a councillor, I've been very much involved in. And going forward, these are going to be huge changes to our communities, and I think it's really, really important that we do take in the views of local areas and how things need to be sort of conducted differently in different areas, depending on the makeup. So again, I think community empowerment is going to be hugely important going forward. I mean, looking at the remit, looking at these legacy reports, there is a massive number of things that we are going to be dealing with. It's hard to say that any are more important than others. But yeah, just with the timescale that we're on in terms of our climate change and our net zero brief, I think that's going to be hugely important going forward.
Thanks very much, Natalie. Yeah, you're absolutely right. It is an enormous remit, but and I think that's why in the next agenda item in private, we will try to kind of focus on what the immediate priorities might be. I'll hand over to Jackie Dunbar.
It is a huge remit, what we've been given, but it's been, well, for me, it's an exciting one as well. Representing Aberdeen Donside, it's probably no surprise that this was the one committee that I was wanting to be on. Going forward, I think Natalie is absolutely right. Consultation is, going out there to the public and to other bodies is going to be the key, because whatever we manage to succeed with this committee, we've got to bring people with us. It's a huge area that we're going to be tackling on, and if we haven't got folk behind us, then we're not going to succeed. For me, living someone who lives near the Hadigan, you're probably not surprised to find out that I'm going to be very keen on the transport and the road infrastructure, but also the energy sector as well. For me, how the Just Transition actually works is going to be key for many people. I've read the legacy reports. I will admit I am going to go back and reread them two or three times because they are huge, but I'm looking forward to working with everybody in the committee and out with the committee going forward.
Thanks very much, Jackie. That's fantastic. And I'll bring in Liam Kerr next. Over to you, Liam.
Thank you, Convener, and congratulations on your new position. Yeah, I think my colleagues have set out some really interesting and full thoughts there. I think for me, the first thing that struck me was actually a Deputy Convener talking about implementation, because I've given this quite a lot of thought. And one of the things that I found most disconcerting when I was on Public Audit Committee in the last session was this issue of targets and delivery, because I'm not convinced that the two things marry. And I think this is a point that actually the Cabinet Secretary would acknowledge in the debate that we had a couple of weeks ago. I think the Cabinet Secretary and I agreed that, you know, it's all very well putting targets in place, but we actually have to deliver on them. And the time for delivery is short, is very short indeed. So, and then there was a ministerial statement last week where I asked about the sanction, like what happens if you miss targets? And I'm not sure Cabinet Secretary was in a position to give me an answer to that at the time. So I think that would be something I'm quite interested in knowing. What targets have we got? What actually are we doing to get them implemented? Are we going to get a delivery? The second thing that occurs, I had a very, very interesting meeting with CalMAC yesterday, just to familiarise myself with the ferries. I obviously know the North Link, for example, very well, but I'm much less familiar with the CalMAC operation. There is the REC report on this, on this area, and the legacy, of course, is very comprehensive. And I know that there's work going on into the structure of our ferries operation going forward. So given that, I can't see beyond doing something on that. I think we really need to drill down into this area, particularly, of course, with our environmental focus, because, again, I don't know that much about shipping, but I have in my mind that the emissions that will be coming from an aging fleet would not be the sort of thing that we want to be seeing going forward. So I think ferries is an interesting area that I do think this committee should explore. And finally, if there's time, the other thing that's in my mind is this public energy company, because I recall the announcements was a significant time. Perhaps this goes back to my targets and delivery piece. I'm not sure that much has come on this public energy company. I stand to be corrected, but I'm not sure it's there at the moment. And I think that's very important. There are social implications of that. There are economic implications of that. So if that isn't being delivered, I find that rather concerning. And I think that this committee, it might be ripe for this committee to look into. So if there were time to cover all of that, I'd be interested in those areas. So, Convener, that's my top three, and I hope that was useful.
Yes, Liam, thank you very much. Very useful. And again, I think you've just highlighted, like other members did, the wide range of potential topics we have in front of us. Let me now pass to Monica Lennon. Monica, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Congratulations to you and Fiona, and I look forward to working with all of the members. Lots of agreement there already, and again, thanks to colleagues on those legacy committees. There's a lot to read in those reports, and like Jackie, I will go back and read them a number of times. I think Fiona is right that, you know, our focus really needs to be on scrutiny and on implementation. We've had a steer on the Transport Act, for example, and there's a lot in that. The climate change plan, we've discussed that already in the chamber since we've come back, so we'll have a big role to play there. Liam Kerr's touched on ferry procurement and future ferries policy. We've obviously got recommendations on that in legacy reports. And I think the Deputy Convener made the point about maybe the fact that we don't represent all of Scotland on this committee, but I think through our work we very much will aspire to do that. And I think that means that we have to, for example, Central Scotland. Ferries are not a big issue for me, but it's a big issue across the country. And I think in terms of how we engage, particularly with younger people, I think we've got a real opportunity to set a really good example, being quite innovative, but also getting out there and doing some interesting visits too. Obviously, when we come back in September, we'll know more about Programme for Government. Circular economy has to be, you know, a massive priority. I'm also very interested in what the government are planning to do around incineration. I know the Minister or the CABSEC has given a commitment on that as well. Transport infrastructure is huge, so we'll need to break that down. One of the things that I'm quite curious about is just how, you know, obviously we're looking at the remit of the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy Transport, but his job depends on performance across government, across all portfolios, and already we know there's some overlap with Marie Goujon's portfolio, but things like 20-minute neighbourhoods, which present real opportunities, the Cabinet Secretary will have responsibility for that strategically across government, but it will dip into lots of other areas. So I'm just interested to see how that all works in practice. I think we've got a job to make sure that government doesn't work in silos, because we all appreciate the really ambitious targets, but the key is delivery and how we get there. Like Liam, also interested to get an update on the public energy company. I think work is underway with the COSLA to develop a business plan. So again, the role of local government is really important. And like others have touched on, you know, just transition, green jobs, making sure that we have the right skills, that we support businesses who want to innovate, and we make sure that, you know, communities are not left behind. So I think it's going to be a really exciting time, and we've got a lot of work to do, and I look forward to working with everyone.
Yeah, thanks very much, Monica. I think you made a number of great points there. That point about the cross portfolio and making sure that we're, you know, not just siloed into a particular portfolio, I think is going to be really important, because that net zero ambition cuts across many, many portfolios. So I think that's the point that's come across from all members. And Mark, let me bring in Mark Russell, Ruskell to bring in his priorities as well. Over to you, Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Dean. congratulations to yourself and also to Fiona. And yeah, really looking forward to working with colleagues across the committee. It's really, really good to hear some early areas of consensus, I think, coming out even in this initial discussion. I did serve on the previous Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. It was a very hard-working committee, as you can see by the 119-page legacy report. And there were some particular challenges, and I think it's good to see this committee picking up on one of the key recommendations, which is that there should be a dedicated net zero committee. So great, step one, we've got a net zero committee. And I think, you know, bringing together some of the key sectors where we've got a real challenge in terms of that just transition into the remit of this committee, I think is really important. And that now mirroring the Cabinet Secretary's responsibilities as well. So, you know, members have already spoken about some of the challenges around energy. The public energy company, I'm interested in that as well. I think we've got massive issues around how we scale up now delivery. So with heat in particular, you know, we've got to see an unprecedented increase in effort and installations to meet the targets and to deliver the progress that's needed. I think with transport too, you know, we've got some key points coming up, strategic transport projects review, national transport strategy, national planning framework as well, all hugely important alongside the climate change plan in terms of how we build the infrastructure that's going to be future-proofed really and is going to tackle the climate emergency. So all of that, I think it makes a lot of sense. What I would say is that, as other members have said, there are a number of other cross-cutting areas that we need to be across. And I would particularly point to the need to work with the other committees that have got responsibility for farming and land use, because that's another key sector where we need to see a transition, but it needs to support farmers and land managers. But we do need to see cuts in emissions there. So again, I'm sort of interested in how we might work quite creatively with other committees, you know, whether we could appoint reporters, whether we could do joint inquiries. I think there's some precedent there, but get out of that kind of siloed scrutiny. We're going to have to work very much across the parliament, and there were some challenges about the last session. And then, yeah, housing and planning, I think, being two other areas where, again, we're going to need to do some cross-portfolio working, I think, to get most out of it. But yeah, really looking forward to the discussions ahead. And yeah, it's the biggest issue, isn't it? So we need to tackle it.
Great, Mark. Thank you very much. And it's great that you sat on one of the predecessor committees, the Environment Committee. I think actually between the members, we covered all of the previous relevant committees. I was on the Economy Committee, and I know other members were on the Rural Affairs Connectivity Committee. So that's great. Working as a team, we can bring that experience to this new committee. I thank all members for their contributions. I think there are a number of areas of consensus, and I think we've all identified that it is a very wide remit. I think the overarching, just in terms of timing, the overarching priority a number of members highlighted was the COP26 conference, primarily because of timing. It begins in early November, and when we return from recess in early September, we will have that, I believe, as one of the focus topics of inquiry, because we will need to hit the ground running and make sure that we cover that topic in a timely fashion. This session is concluded. That was the public section of the first meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Again, I thank members for their contributions. The committee will now go into private session, and we will join the Teams meeting in private session, and that ends this public section of the meeting. Thank you very much, everyone.